5 minutes. And state in South India. My day-to-day activities, this was a place called Base Hospital, where it was similar to a modern GP clinic, but they also had a hospital inpatient beds, and so there was quite a lot of facilities available for patients. My day-to-day activities included seeing and clerking patients, taking their histories and examining them, presenting them back to the doctors who would either confirm my diagnosis or change what I'd written. Day-to-day activities, in addition to that, included just assisting with normal procedures. There were quite a lot of invasive procedures done there, mostly incision and drainage of abscesses. In terms of risks, I think there's a public perception that India's quite risky in terms of safety, but I was fortunate enough not to have encountered anything untoward. Perhaps the only incident where I did was driving. We had a near miss where we almost hit a bus after sunset and the lights weren't off. In terms of perception, I feel initially at least, the other doctors and nurses, because of me being 12 years older than the other medical students and also coming from England, thought I was more experienced than I actually was, so they asked me for second opinions. Nurses would often ask me to confirm a drug dose, and would sometimes ask me to confirm a drug dose, and I had to tell them that I was probably less experienced than they were. I think the hardest part of it was about watching the social structure and hierarchy in terms of wealth and influence, in terms of social structure and hierarchy, in terms of wealth and influence. So even though it was a private hospital, there were also patients who were not paying money or paying what they could afford. There were even a few patients that I'd heard of who'd previously paid in milk from their farms and eggs and even toddy, which is like a local alcohol from coconut. There were a couple of occasions where you'd watch people wait longer because they weren't paying, which I suppose worried me initially, and I thought it wasn't safe. But then over time I realized there's an informal triage system where if someone's unwell, even if they're not paying, they do get sort of seen in order of urgency, but that's by the nurses, and it's not formal, but it does make you wonder about the safety of things. There was one occasion where a doctor refused to see someone, saying he's a malingerer, and he'd come in a few times, but still wrote a prescription for amoxicillin on a piece of paper, and without seeing the patient. So I think this is while he was in the waiting room, and I was meant to see him, and they said, don't bother, and just gave a blank paper with amoxicillin written on it to one of the nurses. There were a few other issues that came about. One was the lower caste, the scheduled caste, tribal people were almost invariably poorer, and they didn't almost always have to wait longer because they weren't paying. We had a government official. There was one occasion which sort of sticks in my mind the most, and that was I was presenting a patient to the doctor. He asked me to bring that patient in when there was already another patient in the room. And so I did, and then someone just walked in and he told all of us, myself and the two patients, to leave sort of mid-consult, and spent sort of half an hour with them, and everyone had to wait because he was the only doctor on there at the time. And I later realized that was a government official, and being government official, you don't have to pay and you don't have to wait. And that sort of just made me wonder about what it was. And this, he came in and sort of just took his shirt. He came in and sort of just pointed to the rationalist chest. He knew that he'd be seen without a doubt. He could just walk in. And it was almost the expectation that he would be able to do that. Antibiotics were rife, and I suppose it's drilled into us that we have to restrict antibiotics and everything about resistance. But there it was, given from everything from a cough or a cold to diarrhea, if it was clearly food poisoning. And I think there were a couple of times where I asked why a patient was given antibiotics, and the reaction I got wasn't ideal. It was, where's he going to go next? He's going to go to another doctor. I'll lose my practice, and my wife's going to divorce me. And it was said, not aggressively, in jest, but I mean, there was almost beneath a veneer, there was, I'm challenging him. And it again brings back the whole hierarchical structure of how it was. And there were a few other occasions with sort of ideas, concerns, and expectations where I thought, I can't really use ideas, concerns, expectations. I got, when I asked a patient, do you have any ideas what this could be? I got a very angry response once, and in a way, it's paternalistic because people aren't involved in their management plan. Sometimes people are seen for a few seconds of that, especially if they're sort of not paying or low paying. And yet they are, because everyone wants antibiotics and they get them. And that's part of how the whole concept of it is they'll get what they want, especially the fee-paying patients. And, you know, people would say, well, I want prednisolone, or I want steroids, even if the indication was questionable, and would get them. And there were patients who, there was one patient that just wanted to be admitted because he didn't feel well. And she was, because it's private. And it made me think about the. There were quite a lot of beds free at the time, but if there weren't, what would happen in that case? Patient wanted to be admitted, comma, beds free, but what if there weren't? There was another case where a patient came in with sort of mild eczema, was given betamethasone and a Nivea prescription, and also a prescription for erythromycin. And I said, oh, why did you give it to him? And again, that sort of, he said, oh, well, it's prophylactic in case he doesn't in case he scratches and gets an infection, then it'll protect against it. And that was another interesting one. And the other thing was Churta, which is a snake. It's a common snake. It's a, I think it's a viper in English. And someone was bitten, and a patient was brought in, bitten by a viper, in quite a lot of pain. And when I saw them, their foot was quite bandaged up, so I couldn't see it, but apparently it was swollen when they came in. And there weren't really ambulances, so they were sent by taxi to one of the larger hospitals while they were on the way. I was just watching people make the phone calls to try to find someone with anti-venom, and that brought up a sort of a whole cascade of events where there was no anti-venom in the local hospitals that were private, but there were in the government hospitals, and the government hospitals don't like taking people from private hospitals. And then there's a massive shortage in India or in Kerala that, because there's one company making them. And I think the learning point was really it's quite similar, or it can be quite similar to here, in terms of making calls and you're trying to get someone else to take this patient. And so I think he was okay, but I knew that, I think people were quite worried about it, because there have been patients that have gone into renal failure and patients that have died after snake bites from vipers. There was a patient who previously had leprosy that I saw. She had no signs on her, but brought up the thing that it's officially eradicated in India, and it doesn't really exist in Kerala anymore. But it's quite a low threshold of eradicated. There were 130,000 new cases diagnosed last year. I suppose the point at which I think the most significant experience I had was I was asked to drain an abscess, and I was with a patient. The doctor walked in, looked at it, said, yep, okay. And I said, incision and drainage, I think. And the patient was systemically well, just an abscess on her foot. And walked straight out and said, that's fine, go ahead, and walked straight out. And I didn't really know what to do, because on the one hand, I didn't want to sort of compromise patient safety, and on the other hand, I was really concerned about the fact that I was being assessed by this doctor, and that I might get a maybe or a no and fail the year before I started it. And and so I sort of followed him, approached him, and said I wasn't comfortable doing it, and I was asked if he could. And he sort of laughed at me, said, oh, how come you don't know how to do this? I'll ask the nurse to do it. And I guess it's quite a common procedure there, but I hadn't done it before. Eventually he came out and let me do it, and let me watch, and that was it.